Section 5.2, Representations of Integers and Integer Algorithms. Okay, we commonly use the decimal representations, but in this section, we're going to learn a binary representation and octal representation and hexadecimal representations of integers. Those are often used, especially in computer science. So given a base B and an integer N, we will show how to construct the base B representation of this integer where B is equal to 2 or 10 or 8 or 16 or any other integers. Okay. A bit is a binary digit that is a 0 or 1. The binary number system consists of two symbols, bit, 0 and 1. An octal number system consists of 8 symbols from 0 to 7. So in computer, the first one is always 0. So 7 represented for the 8th one. The decimal number system consists of 10 symbols from 0 to 9. The hexadecimal number system consists of 16 symbols from 0 to 9, then we have 10. How you name, how you give the name for the 10th one? So A will be a reasonable choice. Then what for 11th? What for 12th is going to be? What for 13th? Mm-hmm. 13th is C, not D. 14th better be D. So here, these are 10 already. So this represents for A, A is used for 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, and 16th. Okay? So that will be a reasonable choice. So we're going to use it in this textbook. The system is based on the base system. So decimal number system, when you have 3854, that actually is equal to 3 × 10^3 + 8 × 10^2 + 8 × 10^5 × 10^10 + 4 × 10^0. Okay? That's the way. So any integer n can be written in this form here for each ai's. Mm-hmm. Then if we write this number with this ak, ak minus 1, dot, 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 a1, and a0, then if you write n as ak, ak minus 1, dot, dot, a1, and a0, then we say this number is written in a decimal number system. Okay? And then we write down the number is written in a decimal number system with 10 itself. Next, binary number system. In binary number system, any integer form is in this way and is written as ak times 2 to the k plus ak minus times 2 to the k minus 1 da, 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 plus a1 to the 2 to the and here We should have a zero here. Mm-hmm. Zero. Mm-hmm. Like this. Okay. Uh-huh. Where each n and each ak is one of the binary digits, 0 and 1. Okay. So if we have 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1 in binary number system, then what do we have is 1 times 2 to the 0, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1 times 2 to the fifth plus 1 times 2 to the cube plus 1 times 2 to the square plus 1 times 2 to the 0. Okay. Mm-hmm. And we write it in this way. So the number is written in a binary number system. Or we write in this way too. Mm-hmm. Okay. With the base B under here. Mm-hmm. First example shows how to compute the representation of given numbers. Okay. Let B is an integer, and B is bigger than or equal to 1, and N is a positive integer, and then N can be expressed in a form like this. Like this. Mm-hmm. And N is equal to AK times B to the K plus da da da, like this. The base B expansion of N. It is called the base B extension of the given number N. Okay? Where K is a non-negative integer and A0 to AK are non-negative integers less than B. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the very largest, very first coefficient shouldn't be 0. Okay, so base B expansion of N is denoted by this. Now, second example shows how we switch the binary number to a decimal number. So suppose we have 101101 in binary number system, then what is this number in a decimal number system. Mm-hmm. Okay. So 101101 square with base 2 can be written as this 1 times 2 to the fifth plus 1 times 2 to the cube plus 1 times 2 square plus 1. Okay. If you add all these, then this is 32 plus 8 plus 4 plus 1, which is 45. And in our decimal number system. So in the decimal number system, this 45, this number can be written as 45 in a decimal number system like this. Mm-hmm. So we have used the decimal number system only so far in this book, so we did not use this base 10 on decimal numbers. And this is the code okay binary to decimal. Okay, if we have decimal number 45, then how it will be represented in a binary, then 101101 is this binary number represents the 45 in a decimal number systems. If you change it as we will continue here. Mm-hmm. So like what you see in here, so this number in binary represents 45 in 45. In decimal number. Mm-hmm. Okay, next. This is the algorithm, the pseudo code that converts a given number from base B to decimal. Mm-hmm. 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 Here is the example. We show how algorithm 2.3 convert the binary number 1101 to decimal. How? If you follow the algorithm, then the number 1101 in binary can be written as 2 to the cube plus 2 square plus 1, which is 13. Okay? And that algorithm will work in that way. We start with n is equal to 3 and b is equal to 2. Then we have coefficient c3 as 1, c2 as 1, c1 is 0, and c0 is equal to 1. Then first, the command dec bell is set to 0 and power is set to 1. Then we then enter the for loop, start from here and do powers and changes it and second power and third power and fourth power. And that gives us, the loop gives us those values, which is 1, 4, and 8, etc. So the addition gives us the number 16, I think. 13. And that's the way that algorithm works. For the loop, terminate and the algorithm returns 13, and the decimal value of the binary number, which is the decimal value of the binary numbers. So the algorithm works like that. Actually, I made the whole code in Python here, and we can do practice. Evaluate it. Then this gives us, suppose we have a binary number of this, then which represents 13. If you have a binary number like this big, then that is 6,997 in decimal. And if you give other number, then it will give the decimal number of this binary number. Okay, so with this code, yeah, we can change easily. And this code was developed based on the pseudo code which was given in the example. Okay, next, octal system. Similarly, yeah, if we have a base 8, then any given integer can be written as this. If you write this number with this coefficient like this, then this is an octal number system representation of a given number, 7,381 in decimal number system. Okay, so in this case, yeah, with those, we find the digit 7361. So actually, 7361. So this should be 6, isn't it?
61.
Mm-hmm.
7, this number.
If we have the octal number system, then 7361, that's what I wanted.
So you can, all you have to do is just write down this 7361 in this form and find out this AKs and write down those coefficients in a row with the base 8. Similarly, for the hexadecimal number system, which has the base, which has base 16, then any integer can be written as AK times 16 to the case plus ak minus 1 times 16 times k minus 1 plus dot 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 plus a1 times 16 plus 16 to the 0 power. It should have a zeros. Okay, like this. So, in a hexadecimal digit, the d, those coefficients can be one of these, from 0 to 9, and the 11th one represented as a, and 12th one is b, 13th, 14th, 15th, and 16th. The last one is f. So we are using these 16 symbols for the possible coefficient AIs. So suppose we have a BF4. Suppose we have this number in hexadecimal number system. What do we have is, B times 16 square plus F times 16 plus 4 times 16 to the zeros power. That is going to be the number of this in the decimal system. Same, it's the same thing. Everything's the same except which number we are using on this place. Binary, decimal, or octal and hexadecimal, or any other basis B. Okay, so for example, if we have a B4F16, then B is what? B is 11 in a decimal system times B 16 square, 4 times 16 plus F times 1. And F stands for the 15 in decimal, so these numbers can be written in this way. And if we add this, which is 2,895 in decimal. Okay, so Angel, you can do it. Okay, next. The opposite, from decimal to binary. Suppose we have 130 in decimal, then how we do write this number in a binary number system? How? We just divide it by 2 over and over again. And then, yeah, these remainders will give us those coefficients. Okay? Like we did in Euclidean algorithm. So easy, very easy. Okay, next. Algorithm shows us how to convert a decimal integer into base B. Okay. This is a pseudo code for that work, and this is the code that we write. If you learn it, then this gives you, suppose we give what? We give 130, then it is 2. Then what was the number that we tried to change it? What was the number? 130, yeah, that's it. 130 in a binary, that is 1000010. Okay. If we have like this number, then in binary, like this, if you change it, if you have this number, then this is the binary number, the representation of decimal number, this. So that algorithm really works. Okay, so now you have everything. And here, this is a more general. If we also made the tool that work for any decimal number to into any basis, not only one.
Control O, Control V.
Then, if you change the base to 8, then this is the number. This is the octal number system 202, which stands for the 130 in decimal number system. If you change it as 16, then what will happen? Then this is 8, and 8 times 16 plus 2, that's it. If you change it as 5, then this is the number. And the, with the base 5, 1010 stands for the decimal number 130. So it really works. So you can refer those numbers. Decimal to hexadecimal, that's what I did. 20385, then we have this. All you have to do is find those coefficients. Let's write it down. Okay, clear? Jang-hyeri? Clear? You can do it. So if I give you any number in any decimal system, any base B number system, you can change it to the other system with base C. No, we haven't learned it. In that case, all you have to do is change that number in base B to decimal and change that to the base C number representation. If you just use it, so you can change the number representation from any base B to any base C. Okay? That's what you have learned. Next, addition of binary numbers. This is a binary number addition table. Here, in binary number system, 0 plus 0 is 0. 0 plus 1 is 1. And 1 plus 0 is 1. What about 1 plus 1 in binary? That is going to be not 2. There's no 2 in binary number system. It's going to be 1, 0. So we, with this addition table, yeah, we can do add these two numbers, 1101 and 111. How is it going to be if we add these two numbers in binary number system? If we add these two, then 1 plus 1 goes to 0 and 1 goes up. So we have 1 and 1 that goes to 0. 1 plus 1 is 1, and 1 goes up. Then we have 1, 1, 1. So 2 goes to 0, so it goes up as 1 up, and 1's left. And then we have 1 and 1, which will make 0 and 1 up. So we have 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and 1, 0, 1, 0, 0. That's the binary addition of two binary numbers. So 1101 plus 111 is 10100. And this is the pseudo code for adding two binary numbers. And this is a real code for that. If you learn it, then if you have two binary numbers like that, then addition goes as 10110, like you did see. If you add these two numbers, okay, then you will have 10110111 like this. So you can do it. Actually, this code was made for adding two binary number with the same digit. You can make change, so you can add any different digit to binary numbers to be added. Okay. That was actually homework in the exercise problems. Mm-hmm. Next, hexadecimal additions. What if we add these two numbers in hexadecimal system? How you add these two? Okay. Mm-hmm. And here, F and A, you have to add it. That is going to be 9 and 1 goes up, and 1 plus 4E gives us 3 and 1 up, and 1 plus 8 plus 2 gives us B, and which is 1 plus 8 plus 2 is 10 and 11, so 11 stands for B, so 4 is left, so 4 will come. So 4B, 3, 9, that's the addition. All you have to do is just after 16, then you go to 0. 15, next one is 0, and then 1 goes up, like that. So those are the simple ideas. So you, now you can add, you can do addition for any base B decimal system. Next, the straightforward way to compute this power is to repeatedly multiply by A. As you see, when you deal with the number system, you're going to see the B square, B cube, B fifth, B four, B tenth, and B to the 100th power of it. So power will be the subject that we have to deal with over and over again. But when you think about this power, then instead of the multiply every numbers in order, if you have a repetition like this, then we can do repeated squaring. That will be better. For example, if we have to compute a to the 29th, then a times a is going to be a squared. Then a fourth is instead of multiply 4, you just add, you just multiply a squared twice. This is once. When you wanted to have a to the eighth, instead of multiply a 8 times, you just find a squared and a fourth, then just multiply 2a to the fourth, isn't it? When you wanted to have a to the 16th power, then you, all you have to do is use the a to the eighth to square. Okay. Then you will save the number of multiplication. Mm-hmm. So the expansion of 2 to the 29 is of, in power of the expansion of 24 in power of 2, then 28 is equal to 1 plus 4 plus 8 plus 16. So when you do compute 8 to the 29th, 8 to the 29th is equal to just 8 times 8 to the 1st times 8 to the 8th times 8 to 16. So what you need is just instead of 29 times of multiplication, we do use only 4 times of multiplication when we have these. Okay. Mm-hmm. So after we find these, then all we have to do is 3 more additional multiplication. So total 7 multiplication is enough to have 8 to the 29th. So we can dramatically reduce the number of multiplication. Mm-hmm. Okay. So binary, so 8 to the 29th can be written in this way. So as you see here, yeah, we did use the binary number system when you do reduce the number of multiplication. Mm-hmm. And his mode 2 multiplication was used. So with those in mind, yeah, we could have the exponentiation algorithm for repeated squaring, like this. Next, the number of times that the while loop executed is terminated by n. So the variable n is repeated halved with this, and when n becomes zero. I think that's what it says. And also, in GM, it is possible to define the addition and multiplication in the following ways. For example, G5 and G6, this is the set of numbers from 0 to 5 stands for the set of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So on the number system with base 5, yeah, we can form a group G5. And if we use the number system of base 6, then we can form a the group G6, which has the addition table like this and multiplication table like this. When you do multiply and we use the number system of modulo 5 here, and if we do use a modulo 6 number system, then we can have the addition table and multiplication table like this. When we use star, then we delete zeros out from G to the M's. And this is a set. Mm-hmm. Next, multiplication in modular arithmetic. And what you did see in here can be seen in here. If A, B, and G are positive integers, then the A, B mod G is same as the product of A mod G time and the B mod G in mod G. So these numbers are same. These are same. So when we have a large number A and B, then instead of multiply this first and do the modular arithmetic with G, we do find the small number, which is A mod G and B mod G first, then multiply those two small numbers to do the modular arithmetic, which will reduce our computation and output. The proof is here. Let W is A, B mod G, and X is equal to A mod G, and Y is equal to B mod G. Then by quotient remainder theorem, A, B is divided by G, so W is the remainder. So there exists Q1 and W like this, and A divided by G, so X is the remainder, and A can be written as Q2G plus X, where X is the remainder. And when B is divided by G, then Y is the remainder, which can be written in this way. So W can be, AB minus Q1G can be written as A is this, B is that, so multiply this and simplify it. Then we have W is equal to QG plus XY, okay, with this arithmetic. So XY is equal to minus QG plus W, which means XY is divided by G, and W, when X, Y divided by G, then W is the remainder, which means W is equal to X, Y in mode G. It's, that says A, B mode G is equal to this. So, this gives us this wonderful property that we're going to use over and over again. Let's see an example. To compute 8329, we successfully computed this. So instead, to compute this in mode G, then instead of we do all this, we do find 8 square and 8 to the 4th and to the 5th, and with those 8 to the 13th power mode G can be written as 8 to the 5th and 8 to the 8th mode G, and that also can is that which is same as 8 to the 5th mode G times 8 to the 8th mode G in mode G. So instead of we doing the computation of 8 to the 13 for a big number A, we do find the small numbers and multiply it into the modular arithmetics. That is very important. For example, when we do compute 29th power of 572 in mode 713, instead of we do compute to this big number, we use these ideas. 8 to the 29th is same as this, like what we did see. So we do find the 8 to the 8th power, and we do find the square, which is simplified, and found as 630, and do square of it in mode 713, and do find the 8th power, and similarly we find the 13th power by multiplying 5th power, which can be simplified in this way. So this number in mode 713 is 417, and the 8th power is 328. So just multiply these two small numbers in mode 713, which gives us 152. So by multiplying these two numbers and do the modular arithmetic in 713, which gives us 113, which is same as this big number in mode 713. Instead of doing this big computation, we do find the small number, which will give us the same number in modular arithmetic. So that's the whole idea. In this example, as you see here, if 10 mode 3 is 1, and 5 mode 7 is 5, and 6 mode 3 is 0. So when you do, when you are asked to find the product of this number in mode 14, instead of multiply this, you do find the mode 2 or 15 mode 40, which is 15, and 2 or 17 mode 40, which is 17, because 2,000 can be divided by 4,000. So these are the remainders. Multiplying product of these two are 255, which is very easy to get in mode 40, so it will, the remainder will be 15. So since we have this, then so we can find it easily here. Similarly, 10th power of 2015 in mode 7, instead of we do find this big number, we do the modular arithmetic first on 2015, then which is 6 in mode 7, then power of this is what? 6 squared is 36. 5 times 7 is 35. So what's the difference? So the remainder is 1. So 1 to the 5th power is going to be 1. So modular arithmetic of this big number in base 7 is just 1. So if you use that theorem, then you can easily simplify this computation to very simple one to get the same answer. Okay, next. And this is a code, pseudo code for those repeated squaring. I think that's the end of section 6.2. And there was some information on famous field medalist Terence Tower, which is still young, and he's one of the genius now, who's working actively, and you see LA, And in the textbook, yeah, you will find something. This is what I told you over and over again. If you know knowledge, then others knows it, shares it. But if you do, is of little significance, but it is very important that you do it. Mahatma Gandhi told that. To know what is right, then better do something. Better do what to do. What is right? Better do what is right. Which was said by Confucius. And those are the things that we are adopting in our class. Next, Euclidean algorithm. Finding GCD of two integers. Finding. Yeah, A is equal to BQ plus R. Then GCD of AB same as GCD of BR. Finding GCD of AB same as finding GCD of BR when A is equal to BQ plus R in Euclidean division. So GCD of 105 and 30 is same as 105 in mode 30 is 15. So GCD of 30 and 15 is 15. Easy. Okay. And GCD of AB is same as GCD of BR. Yeah, this is the theorem. Proof is here. By the quotient remained the theorem. Yeah, A can be written as BQ plus R. Then so the set of common divisors of AB is equal to the set of common divisors of B and R. We're going to prove it. So we're going to show the double inclusion. Suppose we have an element in the left-hand side set. Let's say it's a C. So it is a common divisor of A and B. Then C divides BQ and C divides A and C divides BQ, which means C divides A minus BQ, which is R. So C is also a common divisor of B and R. One inclusion was made. So anything in the left-hand side is included in the right-hand side. If C is a common divisor of B and R, then clearly C divides BQ and C divides R, BQ plus R, which is A. So C divides B and R, A. So C is a common divisor of A and B. So any element in the right-hand side the set belongs to the set in left-hand side. So two sets are same. So common divisors are all same. Then greatest common divisor in each set is greatest number in each set should be same. So we have this. This is very important fact that we're going to use. This is the algorithm that we find for the Euclidean, for the algorithms. And this is the code that we made with those pseudo code that works. So Euclidean algorithm. Here, from this, we can find the common divisor. Yeah, we can find the common divisor of any two integers with this code. Okay. Next, GCD of 504 and 396 is 36. Show it. That algorithm gives us, we start with A and B, and A is bigger than B, then we do the modular arithmetic with the base 396, then we have 108, then we do the modular arithmetic of base 108 on 396, then 396, then we have 72, then we do the modular arithmetic on 108 with the remainder 72, which gives us 36. That's the while loop. And then do the modular arithmetic on 72 with the mode 36, which is 0. So now it's done. So we do the line 6 of those pseudo code this many times to have it. And then what's left is the 36. The 36 R is the 36 is the greatest common divisor of those given two numbers. And here, if we do that, if you put those numbers in here, then we will have 36 without any difficulties. The last part is analysis of the Euclidean algorithm. Okay. Analysis. How effective it is. Okay, when we do that Euclidean algorithm, the worst case is when we have two numbers, A and B, are consecutive Fibonacci numbers. Here is the example. Fair, 91 and 57 is input to the Euclidean algorithm. Then we do the 57 is smaller, so we do the modular arithmetic to 91 with mode 57. Then we have a 31. We call this is a one modular operations. Here we did have about four modular arithmetics. Okay, this is one operations. In here, the smallest input pair that requires n modular operations in Euclidean algorithms are this. If we have A and B, then as you see, we do the one, when we have one and zero, we don't need to do anything. But when we have two and one, then we do one modular operations. When we have three and the next one, then we have to do one more time. Then when we have a five, then we need one operation and earlier operation, which is two, which makes three. When you have eight, then we have the one more operation and the earlier operations. Mm-hmm. So this is the modular operations at each time. The total number of modular operations are the addition of the one and the all the rest, which can be written as the Fibonacci sequence like this. So, suppose we have 91 and 57. Then after one operation, we have 57 and 39. Then it requires four modular operations. So, in order to do the Euclidean algorithm on these two, then we need 4 plus 1, which makes a total of 5 modular operations. Okay, so that gives a relationship like this. We need one modular operation. This requires 4 modular operations, so total 5. So we need 5, and we have a bigger number, so we need one more. So total number of modular arithmetics is bigger than or equal to these two, which is what? The addition of those two is F7 by Fibonacci sequence. So this is the kind of worst case that we have to do the largest number of modular operations. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. And this is suppose the pair A requires the modular operations, suppose we have a pair of positive numbers A and B requires n modular operations when it put to the Euclidean algorithm, then the number of modular operations needed for A is more than Fn plus 2, and the same for B is bigger than or equal to Fn plus 1. Where this Fn denotes the Fibonacci sequence. Mm-hmm. Since times are short, so I ask you to read and discuss on this. Here's all the details of explanations. The next one is, you skip it, as the other class will do it. And Bezos theorem here. Here, Bezos theorem shows us that there exists an integer SNT which gives us the GCD of AB. So there exists an integer SNT that satisfies this. So for GCD can be obtained by this, which was developed by Bezos. So this example asks us to express the GCD one as a linear combination of these two numbers. And this algorithm shows us how to find it. And this is the pseudo algorithm for that recursive Euclidean algorithm, and that's the modification. And these other things. And this is just C program for GCD of finding GCD of two numbers. And with this code, then we will find those GCD. Computing an inverse modular an integer, and yeah, we can discuss in Q&A, but I will not give an exam problem from this. I think that's the end of section 5.3, and section 5.4 is RSA public key cryptosystem. RSA stands for the inventor, Levesque and Shamir and other man. And this is the crypto system that we are using these days. This crypto system are using this modular arithmetic that we have studied today. And that's the end of it. And here is the problems and solutions that we already we solved last semester. And you can study this and discuss this problem. And I gave you the other problems here. I think we have solved about 70% of these problems. And some are left. So yeah, if you solve some new interesting problems among these which was not solved, then I will, after we finalize it in this week and next week, then we will use those problems for your midterm examinations. Any questions? Okay, then time's up.